Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 28 February 2019. The articles we'll be seeing for prelims today are these six. The first news item talks about the Geneva Convention. Second article talks about the near extinction of a pangolin species. Third article is about the Forest Dwellers Act and the related international conventions associating to it. Fourth article is about regulating drug prices in our country, especially for the essential drugs. Fifth article is about physical deficit with respect to Indian states. And the final article talks about the centers borrowing from National Small Savings Fund. The first article we'll be seeing is taken from the paper Hindu. Indian Air Force plane shot down, pilot taken captive by Pakistan Army. So in this news item for prelims, we have to study about one important international convention called as Geneva Convention. So this Geneva Convention was signed in the year 1949 after Second World War. And this Geneva Convention consists of series of protocols and sub-protocols. And there are four main protocols apart from the additional protocols. We'll discuss about them in this article. So according to this Geneva Convention, it mandates that the parties to war to remain humane to non-combatants such as civilians and even medical personnel. Apart from it, it also talks about the treatment to the prisoners of war. In this context, it talks about four important provisions dealing with prisoners of war. So the nations in treating with prisoners of war must avoid violence to life of a person, murder of all kind, cruelty and torture. It also talks about taking of hostages and the treatment associated with it. Outrages to personal dignity in particular and any humiliating and degrading treatment must be avoided according to Geneva Convention. This convention also bans sentencing a person or any execution without proper previous judicial pronouncement with a court that is regularly constituted with the permission of both the countries involved. So this convention guarantees principles of justice that is indispensable by any civilized people. So apart from this, there are four main treaties involved in this convention. The first Geneva Convention, it talks about improving the condition of wounded and the sick soldiers. The second Geneva Convention talks about protecting the wounded and the sick combatants who are traveling on board on ship or at sea during the war. Third Geneva Convention talks about the prisoners of war and treating them humanely. And the fourth one talks about the protection of civilians in case of an armed conflict. The second article for the day is Nearing Extinction. This article is taken from the paper The New Indian Express. Four species of pangolins are either in category of critically endangered according to IUCN. And this is attributed to a high scale of pangolin trafficking, as pangolin is considered as world's most trafficked animal. Let's discuss about the IUCN status and the threats of these species. So in this article, we'll be seeing about four main species of pangolin. The first species is Chinese or Formosan pangolin. This pangolin is relatively smaller in size when compared to the Indian version of the pangolin, and the IUCN status is critically endangered for the Chinese pangolin. Among the other varieties of pangolins, this Chinese pangolin is considered to be the most trafficked because of the high demand for its scales and meat, as there is associated traditional value in Chinese system. According to IUCN report, the Chinese pangolins have declined greatly in past 15 years. And about 1 million pangolins have been poached since the year 2000. And pangolin is considered as a only mammal with scales. This scale is a natural evolution which serves as an armor against any natural predators to pangolins. However, this is the very same scale that attracts human beings, and it makes pangolins as the most trafficked animal. And the scales are also used for traditional purposes according to traditional Asian medicine, especially the Chinese medicine. The second type of pangolin we'll be seeing is Philippine pangolin or Palawan pangolin. And this pangolin is larger than the Chinese pangolin, and it has endangered species according to IUCN. This pangolin species, it mainly resides in primary and secondary forests, and it even lives in grasslands as against Chinese pangolins. And this pangolin is present only in Philippines, so it is endemic to Philippines. However, the Chinese pangolin, apart from China, it's also present in India, Thailand, Nepal, Vietnam, Myanmar and Laos. The third type of pangolin is a pangolin present in our country, that is Indian pangolin, and it's also called as stick-tailed pangolin. This is also endangered species according to IUCN. And this is a relatively larger species, and this species, it eats insects. So it's often called as ant eater. Apart from ant, it also eats cockroaches, beetles and termites. And another important species about Indian pangolin, it is a nocturnal animal. So it's active during nighttime, and it's also a solitary and extremely terrestrial species. The fourth type of pangolin is Sunda pangolin, or the pangolin which is present in the Malay Peninsula. This is also critically endangered like the Chinese pangolin. And distribution of this pangolin is in Cambodia, Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, Thailand and Vietnam. And this pangolin is closely related to Chinese pangolin and it looks similar to Chinese pangolin. And this pangolin is listed in Appendix 1 of CITES Convention, which means that the trade of any body part associated with this pangolin is completely prohibited. The third article for the day is Modify Forest Dwellers Eviction Order. According to Center's claim, this Supreme Court order of eviction of the forest dwellers on February 12 is without observing due process of law and this order must be reconsidered. The Center has filed the application to modify the Supreme Court order that was issued on February 13. So the order was issued by the Supreme Court to evict thousands of scheduled tribes and the other forest dwellers from their claims of forest land rights. The peoples whose claims are rejected according to the provisions of Forest Rights Act 2016 are forced to be evicted from the forest they are currently occupying. And in this context, for the prelims exam, we have to know about the associated international conventions related to Forest Rights Act 2006. The first convention is UN Universal Declaration on Human Rights. So this convention, it recognizes that equal rights must be awarded to every human being. And equal rights of a human family is also recognized. And India is signatory to this convention. The second convention is United Nations Convention Concerning Indigenous and Tribal Population. This convention protects the tribal population and the rights of this population, especially with respect to the ownership rights. It seeks to give the ownership rights to these tribal groups for the lands they are traditionally occupying. India has both signed and ratified this convention of United Nations. The third convention is United Nations Declaration on Rights of Indigenous People. This convention is different from the convention which we saw before, which deals with the property rights. So this convention, it seeks to protect the rights of the people, their territories and even the resources associated with them. The resources that are traditionally owned and occupied and used by the tribal people are protected under this convention. India is a signatory to this convention too. The fourth convention is United Nations Convention of Biological Diversity. This convention protects the indigenous knowledge and the practices followed by the tribal people. And as we all know, India is a party to United Nations Convention on Biological Diversity. Apart from all these, there's yet another declaration called the Rio Declaration on Environment and Development. And this Rio Declaration, it recognizes the role played by the tribal people, especially the vital role played with them with respect to environmental management. According to Rights of Forest Rights Act 2006, the Gram Sabhas are designated as a nodal agencies for initiating the verification process and also addressing the claims of the tribal people. However, due to low awareness of the tribal people on how to deal with dreams, and also the fact that the rejection of the claims are not even communicated to the forest tribal people properly, are the main reason for this eviction. The center has also argued that there is no specific provision in the Forest Rights Act 2006 for eviction after the claim is being rejected. So, due process of law must be followed before rejecting the claims of the forest dwellers. The next article is about the regulating drug prices. This article talks about the need for making more drugs affordable. It also talks about the provisions under drug pricing order and also national list of essential medicines. As we all know in our country, the out-of-pocket expenditure with respect to health and medicines is very, very high. According to recently released report of NSSO, 70% of the total out-of-pocket expenditure with respect to the health facilities comes from medicine alone. So in this context, we have to know how the prices of the medicines in our country are regulated. So with respect to prelims, we need to know about two important things. First is the Drug Price Control Order, which is released by Department of Pharmaceuticals. And second is the National List of Essential Medicines, which is released by the Health Ministry. So the Drug Price Control Order, it mainly controls the prices of all essential medicines. So it controls by fixing some basic ceiling of price beyond which the drugs cannot be sold out in the external market. How is this fixing decided? So the prices of the drugs, mainly the essential drugs, are fixed based on an order released. The order is called as National List of Essential Medicines. And this list mainly consists of the essential medicines that satisfy the priority health needs of Indian population. The list also takes into consideration the safety, the efficacy and the disease prevalent currently in deciding the essential medicines list. And the prices of the drugs is also periodically updated based on the current prevalence decided by expert committee set up especially for this purpose under Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. The prices of these drugs are currently decided on the market-based mechanism. And using this market-based mechanism, authority called as NAPA, National Pharmaceutical Pricing Authority, it fixes the prices of the different formulations. So currently about 800 drug formulations are awarded this essential medicines tag in our country. And this 800 formulation, they constitute about only 10% of the total pharmaceutical market. This can be reasoned as one important reason for making the medicines less affordable to Indian public. And a series of health experts opine that this 10% of the total pharmaceutical market drugs must be expanded to cover further drugs. The fifth article for today is about physical deficit. The physical deficit of 19 states are worst in past 8 years. This article is taken from the paper, The New Indian Express. Before seeing the expansion of physical deficit of states, we need to understand what physical deficit is. Physical deficit is basically the budget expenditure minus the total budget receipts, excluding the borrowings. So basically this physical deficit, it indicates how much the central government or the state government has actually borrowed to meet its needs. So according to recently released report by a private agency, the physical deficit of the states is becoming a great matter of concern. The deficit of 19 states, including the developed states such as Kerala, has increased several times. About 19 states in our country have a physical deficit of about 25% more than the actual estimated deficit, and this is the highest in past 8 years. Especially states like Bihar, Rajasthan, Kerala and Madhya Pradesh, they have almost breached the full year targets in the first 3 physicals alone. States like Bihar, Kerala, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh have almost breached the full year targets during the first 3 quarters alone. In case of Kerala, the floods which occurred to the state in the last year can be attributed as one of the major reasons for the increasing physical deficit. Not just the physical deficit of the states, but also the center's physical deficit is seeing an increasing trend. The center's physical deficit is almost 112% of the total expected budget deficit, and this is also highest in past 20 years. And another important point is this issue of increasing physical deficit is also being flagged by the Finance Commission by its chairman N.K. Singh. And this issue of increasing physical deficit is also being flagged as a very important issue by Mr. M.K. Singh, who is currently the chairman of Finance Commission. This article is also a continuation of the topic physical deficit. Borrowings from National Small Savings Scheme risks understating deficit. So this is according to a newly released report. So in this article, we'll see about National Small Savings Schemes and why center and the states borrow from it in order to finance its physical deficit. So small savings schemes have always been a very important source of savings for common households in our country. And there is a special fund called as National Small Savings Fund that has been established in the year 1999 under Public Account of India. For managing this small saving collection, all the small saving collections directly goes into this National Small Savings Fund, and the balance in this fund is utilized by both the state as well as center to finance its physical deficit, and the center and the states uses these funds to invest in other instruments such as government securities. However, the concern now is that the government has borrowed from National Small Savings Schemes in the fiscal year 2019, but the borrowings runs the risk of understating the physical deficit. Currently, the government has borrowed of about $500 billion from National Small Savings Scheme alone. It approximates to almost 22% of the total budgeted physical deficit. Though borrowing from a single source by the government can pose a series of threats, there are other positives attributed to this borrowing too. The borrowing from this NSSF will definitely ease the pressure with respect to the government securities and keep the cost of government borrowings through external budgetary resources low. So, this external budgetary resources are nothing but the liabilities raised by the public sector undertakings for which a repayment is done by the union government via its budget allocatement. This borrowings from the external budgetary resources will be low because of the borrowings from the NSSF. Thank you.